Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome on behalf of the two of us. Over the next 45 minutes, we are going to try to tell you a lot, not all, but a lot about the unique research we did over the summer in the town of Oudewater in the Netherlands. This will not be easy because we are going to try to summarize 2 years of work into 45 minutes, and that is really quite a challenge. But we'll try to make you part of our considerations, and we'll also try to present you the first impression we have of the results, of the findings. But beforehand, we ask you to see them as what they are. They are first observations. They are not the conclusions. We only managed to digest the first 20% of all the data we obtained. So we still got 80% to go. And that is why we really cannot explain everything that we are going to show. So that's interesting. But we know that you're very curious, as we are, so we're just going to give it a try.
Yes. So, we would like to introduce ourselves first. So this is Hans. Hans is a firefighter. Hans is a senior officer. And Hans gets really itchy if he sees any formula. So don't talk about formulas with Hans, but if you want to know something about situational awareness or the human factor, he is likely to answer his questions.
Yeah. And well, this is Lieve. Lieve de Witte, 40 years old, proud not to be a firefighter, but has a great scientific knowledge about fire and fire development. And Lieve lives by the motto, a formula a day keeps the doctor away. So if you have questions about formulas, please go to Lieve. I acted as overall project manager for this research, and Lieve is in charge of the actual research part of it. And first, we would really like to ask René about why we are doing this research.
Door een brand in de nacht van zaterdag op zondag in een voormalig seniorencomplex aan de Witte Brug in Poeldijk zijn zeker 40 appartementen tijdelijk onbewoonbaar. Volgens de brandweer zou in het complex een scooter in brand zijn gevlogen, wat gepaard ging met veel rook dat via een traphuis of liftgracht omhoog trok.
Nou, deze zijn heel belangrijk om twee redenen. Wij zien de laatste jaren bij branden steeds meer dat er rookverspreiding komt. Dus gebouwen komen steeds vaker onder de rook te staan. En anderzijds zien we dat in dit soort appartementsgebouwen steeds vaker oudere mensen komen te wonen die veel minder snel kunnen vluchten. Dus die combinatie van meer rook en minder snel kunnen vluchten is gewoon letterlijk en figuurlijk, blijkt uit de cijfers, dodelijk. We hebben er heel veel onderzoek naar gedaan, literatuuronderzoek, simulaties gedaan. Maar het sluitstuk is nu dat we gewoon praktijktesten nodig hebben om exact te weten wat er is. En met name daarmee te laten zien en te kunnen uitzoeken wat moeten we eraan gaan doen. Moet het in regelgeving, moet het in betere constructies, moet het in betere voorlichting. En dat hopen we met deze testen te bereiken.
So, ladies and gentlemen, as you saw, this research really is the final piece of work in a long line of former work done by the Fire Service Academy. We have investigated in Zutphen, we have investigated fatal fires, we have investigated fire prevention in relation to the elderly. But what we actually needed was practical experiments on a large scale to actually observe what is happening inside such a building when a small fire is ignited and to see how smoke propagates through the building. And as we know, fire and fire development depend on a lot of factors. That was the conclusion of Zutphen, as we remember. So we had to make choices, because if we didn't have to make choices, we would have had the possibility to do about hundreds, perhaps even thousands of experiments. And on such a scale, that simply is not possible. So we had to make choices. And we decided on putting the focus on the possibilities for tenants to escape and to survive a fire in such a building. So the effect on smoke propagation, on the survivability and the possibilities to escape such a building was the focus of this project. And this main focus resulted in research in a residential building with indoor corridors. And we decided upon using just one fire scenario to make the results comparable in the end. And that is also why we also chose to use each time one sofa. Lieve, can you tell us a little bit more about the developments in smoke propagation and what we actually want to know exactly?
Yes. So what do we want to know now? So if you look at fire development and smoke production and smoke propagation, you have to look at the whole scenario, so at all these stages. And if you do that, you have to start at the beginning. So what we did in our fatal fire study is we looked at ignition sources. We also looked at the objects of origin. So for example, in our data, we saw that in 25% of the cases, furniture was the first object to burn. So if you move from the source, and if you have a source, you can try to make this source better. So this is why we also do some research and collaboration with IKEA to make their furniture more fire safe. But in the end, if you have a source and it's burning and it's producing smoke and smoke will propagate, then you have to do something after this first source. You can think about suppression by hand or by a system. But still, even then, smoke is propagating. So somewhere you want to try to shield off or to keep the smoke in one room. So that's where some kind of smoke resistance come into place. And if you look further, if you have smoke in the corridor, you should also look at the human factor. So you should also look in what to do and how to train or advise people what to do in case of fire. You could also look in how to remove smoke from rooms. And in the end, of course, there's the fire service. So they want to rescue or to evacuate people, or they want to attack the fire. Should you do that in one kind of following system, or should you first, for example, rescue and then firefight, or should you first attack the fire and then rescue people? So actually, what we want to know is we want to know how this smoke is propagating in all those stages. And as a researcher, yes, you think, okay, we have some nice videos where you can see what's happening. We move from natural materials to synthetic materials, which produce more smoke. Actually, those two videos, that's not really the case, what we see in actual fires. What we see in actual fires is, of course, the fire stays in the object, but in most of the cases, it's underventilated, or there is a lack of oxygen. So if you have a material which produces a lot of smoke, and you remove the oxygen, it will actually produce more smoke. So that's why we want to focus on a kind of a common scenario which we see in daily practice. Okay, so let's move to the next slide. So if I must summarize this, how can you see this? Now, if you look at escape, you have two kinds of times. You have the available safe time or escape time or egress time, which is dependent on the smoke propagation. So how fast the smoke is propagating will depend on how much time you have. But on the other hand, people need time to escape, which is the required egress safe time. What we see in the Netherlands is that elderly people stay longer in their homes, which means that they are less resilient to go to the escape routes, or they need more time to escape. So what actually is happening is that the available safe time is getting shorter because the smoke is propagating faster. But on the other hand, the required safe time is getting longer. So where you normally should have like a margin of safety, this margin of safety is getting shorter, or maybe is even getting, how do you say that?
Doesn't exist anymore.
Doesn't exist anymore, yes, thanks Hans. So this is quite a wrong thing. You know, it's quite the opposite movement that you want. So, and this also brings you to all the discussions about stay in place, stay put, or defend in place. So if you want to leave your apartment and you open your door and the corridor is already filled with smoke, then the building regulations could say you have to escape. But if you can't, what are you going to do then? So in our experience, we not only want to focus on how the smoke propagates, but also we want to look at, okay, what does this mean for our building codes or our system in how we deal with escape or not? Okay. So Hans, yeah, I now already told you what we need. So mm-hmm. That sounds really simple. So yeah, tell us.
Yeah, basically it indeed is simple. All you really need is a building, a residential building. You need about 25 sofas. Then you simply have to put the sofas in the building and light them on fire and simply observe what is going to happen. But in reality, of course, things turned out to be rather complicated. Simply acquiring the building, for instance.
How much buildings did we look for?
We looked at approximately 30 buildings, but almost all of them were due for demolition within 1 or 2 months of reporting them to us. And 1 or 2 months is simply too short for us to prepare the experiment. So we had to disappoint a lot of fire brigades in the Netherlands who came up with very good buildings, but simply they were not usable for this purpose. And second of all, the sofas.
That sounds the easiest part.
Yeah, you remember the time when you ordered 25
yes,
sofas?
Yes.
And you also remember that moment when you received the email which said that the delivery company thought that ordering 25 sofas couldn't be right, so they simply cancelled the order.
Yes.
No.
About 1 to 2 weeks before we were going to start the experiments.
Yeah.
And finally, of course, all the measurement equipment. Doing research into smoke propagation really is uncharted territory. So we really had to find out ourselves a whole lot about what equipment to use, how to use it. And a lot of that equipment was not made to be used in the circumstances which we did. They weren't prepared for heat, for smoke, for radiation, etc. So we had to take a lot of measures to make it possible. But in the end, all came right. We acquired a building through the help of the Oude Water Fire Brigade. The safety region of Utrecht partnered up in the experiments. The sofas were delivered. The equipment was delivered. The local authorities granted permission so we could do the experiments, because, of course, we were 20 to 25 times going to produce smoke. And that's, of course, something to look into. So perhaps it's interesting to look more at the actual characteristics of the building, now knowing that all the preconditions were met.
Yes, so we found a building, and then you start looking at the plan and say, okay, where do we want to do the test, and how are we going to do this? We knew that we had 2 weeks where we could do experiments, and we wanted to do 2 experiments a day. So then you decide, okay, if you are a researcher, then you look from a research perspective, and then you want all the variations to go away. So no variations, only controlled variations. And one thing you know for sure, if you have a real building, there are a lot of variations. So that's a problem. This problem also came to when you look at the floor plan. In the end, we chose 2 fire rooms. Why? Because we had to change during the day. Because if you're doing 1 experiment in a room, this room stays warm, it's contaminated. If you want to have the second test the same day in the afternoon, you need to do a lot of stuff. But in the end, you want also the other measurement equipment as fixed as possible. Because if you have to move equipment, this comes all kinds of different problems. You have to test it again, you have to monitor it again, so you don't want to do that. So in the end, we chose 2 fire rooms, which are most representative for the smoke spread through the smoke propagation to the corridor. And we had only to move the equipment from the fire room to the other fire room. And Let me have a look. Yeah, that's not all. If you go into this building, this is an old building from the 70s, I think, yep. somewhere. You don't want, if you have a fixed scenario where you say, okay, I only want the sofa to burn and nothing else, then you also have to remove everything else which could burn. So we had to do a kind of renovation of the building, which was quite something.
Partial demolition.
Partial demolition, yes. So, okay, what I can tell you a lot about is maybe it's better to have a kind of a video tour to the building.
We gaan in Oudewater gaan we onderzoek doen naar rookverspreiding in woongebouwen. Dat gaan we doen samen met de veiligheidsregio Utrecht. En we gaan daarbij zo veel mogelijk proberen de praktijkomstandigheden van een echte brand in een woongebouw te simuleren. Dat betekent dat we op de eerste verdieping van een pand van 4 bouwlagen een beperkte brand gaan creëren. En vervolgens gaan vastleggen hoe vervolgens de rook zich door het pand gaat verspreiden. En welke maatregelen invloed daarop hebben en eventueel dus ook bij kunnen dragen aan het beperken van rookverspreiding. Daarbij kun je denken aan bijvoorbeeld rookwerende deuren of sprinklers. Maar we kijken ook heel nadrukkelijk naar de wijze waarop de brandweer inzet bij een dergelijk incident. Daarbij moet je denken aan, is het nou als je als eerste bevelvoerder aankomt handig om eerst te gaan redden voordat je gaat blussen? Of is het handiger om eerst te blussen voordat je gaat redden?
We staan hier in de brandruimte van het onderzoek naar rookverspreiding. Achter mij ziet u een boom staan. Op die boom gaan we allerlei metingen uitvoeren. Waaronder temperatuur, straling en drukken. Daarnaast gaan we ook nog gassen meten. Nou, dat zijn eigenlijk de dingen die we zo'n beetje meten. Die gassen doen we eigenlijk vooral met name voor overleefbaarheid. En temperatuur, rooklaaghoogte, zicht en straling. Daarvoor kijken we ook vooral naar vluchtveiligheid. Nou, dat zijn in essentie de dingen die we willen weten. Die willen we weten hier in de brandruimte. Maar ook in de gang hiernaast, in andere appartementen en op deze verdiepingen.
So this is an impression of the floor plan of the first floor, where we actually can see all the positions that our measurement and video equipment was installed. In total we had over 100 points where the temperature was measured. 10 points for heat radiation, a lot of points for pressure. Gases were measured at over than 20 points. And 34 camera positions. That's Joost is sitting in the corner. He's watching them at the moment. And you have to know that 34 positions, 20 tests, and about an hour test, so you know how much hours he is spending at the moment in looking at all the video footage that we have.
Just look at his eyes.
Yeah. We also look at the optical density, very important in terms of escaping fire. And finally, we needed more than 1 kilometer of cables to install all this equipment. So you have to know that. It was the first floor, but also the second and third floors and the ground floor. They all had to be connected up to the control room, where all the data was collected and observed during each experiment. So you know how much meters of cable were rolled out in the building to make this all possible. But I think you're at this moment very much interested in what actually happened and how each test was performed. So let's take a look at that.
11 uur gaan we starten.
Ja, ik ga nu naar.
Ja, is goed. Ruud, ben jij in positie?
Jongen, ik zou klaar voor.
Dan gaan we beginnen over 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Aansteken.
Vlammen in de bank. Over.
Dank je. 3, 2, 1, nu.
Deur open houden.
deur nog open houden. Ik tel af wanneer die dicht mag.
We gaan eruit, we laten de deur open, over.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, deur dicht.
Oké. Okay. So that's the first impression. This video was shot at the preparation week. If you look at the corridor, it was nice, like white paint. We have some more videos and look at the difference. This will give you an idea what's happening. So then we did 20 experiments and we collected a lot of data. And then we needed to analyze the data. Hey, that's where my specialty comes really into focus, but you have to understand that if you collect data with those systems, they give you like a bucket full of raw things. And by raw, I mean they focus mainly on collecting faults. So from faults, you have to use formulas to go to what you want to know, and then you end up still with a lot of data which you cannot read. So you need some kind of system how to do this. So let's start this video because this is something we made. It's just an example for how you can translate data into some kind of charts. And then if you have all kinds of charts, then exactly the analyzers come into place. So you need a lot of steps before you can analyze data. It's not just okay, now we're going to look and going to see what's happening. So there are a lot of steps involved, and of course I can talk about this whole day, Hans, but I
was going to cut you short because I think we our audience is more interested in the results than in the analysis part of the job.
This is kind of a candy shop for me, but so let's go to the results.
Okay, actually we have five first observations that we want to share with you that we will work through in a moment. First of all, repeatability and reliability. Second of all, the effect of the opening of the entrance door. Third of all, the smoke-resistant separation. Fourth, the mobile water mist system that we tested. And finally, the fire service tactic that was employed. And looking at repeatability and reliability, this is something actually that we're very proud of as researchers, because as you see, we see some graphs appearing while you're looking. These are the temperature graphs of the hallway of the fire room in four different scenarios. Yes. Similar scenarios, but different scenarios.
Yes, this is a fire room and the most upper thermocouple.
Upper thermocouple in the hallway. And what you can see is that the similar tests also produce similar results or similar graphs. And that means a lot in terms of the reliability of the research that we are actually doing.
Yeah, you see here one is kind of different.
The yellow one.
Yeah, so those are things we still don't know yet why. You could say easily, okay, this fire got more oxygen, so after some period was getting bigger. But something else is that the yellow one was at the end of the second week, where the other three were in the first week. So it could be due to weather conditions or something we did during the weeks. Yeah. We don't know yet. So those are the things that we're still looking for and still analyzing.
Yeah. And the same similarity can also be found in the scenarios where the door was actually closed after opening. We had each scenario for the first 5 minutes, the door of the fire room would be closed. Then the occupant would escape. And after escape, he would either close the door or leave the door open. These were two of the variables that we checked over. Well, in this one, the door was closed again. And again, we see that in the baseline scenario, but also the other scenarios where that front door was closed, there is very great similarity. So actually, our first observation in this research is that all our other observations are pretty reliable.
Yeah, and you also see this in the end result of the burned sofas. So thanks to Simco, who is also here, we have pictures just after the fire department or the firefighters extinguished the fire. And I put here almost all the scenarios here. And you can play kind of a memory game with them. So if you do that, Hans, yes. So those are three similar scenarios. Those are also three similar scenarios. And you could go on with this. So those are similar. And if you look at them, you can see that the end result is almost kind of a copy. And we didn't copy this, eh? So this is a real result. So from a researcher kind of a perspective, if you do a setup in this kind of building and you end up with kind of this comparable results, that's really nice. That's really nice and gives you really a good boost to go on. Okay. So let's go to the second observation. And the second observation is about opening the door between the apartment and the corridor. So in the Netherlands, they're not self-closing, or actually some are, but most of them are not self-closing. So let's look at a video where the door is opened after 5 minutes and what's happening. You see a camera at 1.5 meters in the corridor, which is looking from the side of the corridor into the corridor. So let's start the video. You can see that the smoke is like a wave going through the corridor, and within 20 seconds, the visibility at 1.5 meters is gone. So you could say if the door is going to open, this corridor is going to fill with smoke. And actually, of course, it matters how long it stays open, but you can see that if it's only open for a couple of seconds, this corridor is filled. So what is important? Important is that the door, if the door goes open, when it goes open, so when in the scenario, and for how long it stays open. But it would be wrong to only focus on the door, because what's happening before the door is opened is also important, because there's a buildup of a lot of smoke. So you make the door too much of important if you only look at this. So that's why, and we will give you an idea later on, we think you should look at more factors. Okay, let's go to the second video. Here you see on the upper right the fire room, at the upper left the fire room, and upper right you see the camera facing the door in the corridor. It's the fire room, and you see the visibility or a camera on 30 centimeters and on 1.5 meters. So at the bottom right, this is the same as you saw before. As you can see, visibility is gone quickly at 1.5 meters. And also, if you look at the scenario in the fire room, you can see that the smoke is still produced and still lowering also in the fire room, and still giving smoke and smoke propagation to the hallway. So in this case, the door stays open, so you can see what happens. And you can also see that the smoke layer is going down in the corridor, but at 30 centimeters, there's still kind of a good visibility. Of course, this will change if you walk through it, because then you are mixing the smoke with the cold layer. Yeah. But you can see here what's going to happen.
Yeah. And actually, what this also shows, I think, is the vulnerability of relying on a door as being the single method of containing smoke.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's go to the next observation.
Yeah, all both the fire rooms that we had were upgraded to the level of the new Dutch BBL norm, of the BBL norm, which says that extra smoke resistance is mandatory for all new constructions. That meant that we put in place extra smoke-resistant doors, that we closed up the ventilation shafts, and also took some measures to reduce air leakage through the facade of the building and also to the corridor. And what you actually see here is two positions. First, you have to look at 1.21. That's the fire room that we're looking at. And this is a graph of the corridor measured on measurement equipment tree number B5, as it says on the slide. And actually, we see two phenomena in this. First of all, that before the opening of the door, after 5 minutes, as we have done in each scenario, we actually don't see very much difference between the extra smoke-resistant door and the normal door, which was placed in this building beforehand.
Sorry, Hans, I have to interrupt, yeah. Because it's not only the door, it's yeah. the whole separation. So yeah. we also looked at the ventilation shafts and all yeah. other cracks and seams. So actually, we made the whole separation more smoke-resistant.
Yeah. And second of all, we see that after opening the door, there is a difference. We can actually see a difference in terms of the concentration of carbon monoxide in the corridor through the original smoke-resistant separation and the new smoke-resistant separation. And it seems at this, if you simply look at this graph, it seems quite positive. But looking at a different graph of the same test, of a different room, a different view erupts. Because if you look at the room next to the fire room, number 1.20, where measurement equipment tree number B2 was installed, there we actually see that before opening the door, there's an added concentration of carbon monoxide within this room compared to the original smoke separation that was installed. So in this instance, in that particular room, there may have been negative results. So this all points to the fact we really don't know yet what is actually happening. We suspect it has to do with the pressure difference, but we don't know yet exactly, and so we don't actually know whether we should say, well, this is a positive or negative measure to be installed.
Yeah, what's interesting about the orange line is that you see the two spikes. So yep. before opening and after opening, we see the same spikes in the pressure differential we measured. So this could be some kind of reason. And if you think about it, some kind of explanation could be that if you make one separation more smoke resistant, that you're creating overpressure and that it will go to the weakest point. Yep. And I will show you some video later where you can see what's becoming a weak point then. So the fourth observation is about the mobile water mist system. So this is a system which you can just put in one single room or one single apartment. It has a container or a reservoir with 130 liters of water, and it acts on a smoke detector and a heat detector. So let's look at a video where we compare at the upper the normal situation, so without the mobile water mist system, and beneath with a mobile water mist system. In this case, after 5 minutes, the door is opened and it stays open. So the video is cut a bit, so it will change this in time. But now you see the fire progressing, and after, say, 1 minute, 50 seconds, the mobile water system is going. And you can see that the fire is still growing a bit, but then it stays at some kind of level. So the fire is not extinguished, but it stays on a kind of a smaller level than in the normal situation. You could also see that visibility is changed in the fire room, which is, of course, maybe logic, because there is steam produced and there's a lot of turbulence. So the visibility is going the other way, I think. And if you look at the hallway or at the corridor, you will see after the door is opened that there is still smoke going to the corridor. But this smoke is different to density or to yep. soot, I think. So something we also have to look at. But the visibility is better and there's less temperature in the corridor. So you can say the water mist system, mobile water mist system, it's better than having not this system. But is it the silver bullet? No, it isn't. No. Because you can see that you need the door as well. So if the door stays open, in this case, after the reservoir is empty, the fire will grow again. So in the case where the door is closed, you will see that actually the fire is extinguished. So you can see that what's happening here, you need multiple things to have a better situation.
Yeah. And as we said with the smoke resistant separation earlier on, we haven't digested all the information yet. So for instance, we haven't actually looked at the carbon monoxide levels of these both hallways. And we know that carbon monoxide is invisible. So there may be a whole different situation than we are looking at this moment. Fifth observation concerning the fire service tactic that is employed. And I think it's very important to remember that the fire service will arrive in very uncertain circumstances, in which it will probably not exactly clear which tactic should be the optimum way to contain the incident. My colleague Thijs will talk tomorrow more in the workshop a lot more about the choice between should we prioritize firefighting or should we prioritize rescue. But today we'd like to focus on the effect of ventilation by way of the fire service tactic. And we have to remember that simply deploying the fire service to do something within that building will mean that the ventilation profile of the building will change. And there is a lot of pressure on the fire service in the moment we arrive to act. The public usually don't really trust the fire service to stand outside and do nothing. So we have to do something in terms. We're going to look at two clips of film showing what happens when the fire service shows up, opens up the fire compartment and starts ventilating. We're going to look at that from two viewpoints. One is from the first hallway next to the compartment where the fire is. And the second viewpoint is from a second smoke resistant separation that we installed in order to see what happens behind two separations.
Yeah, and you have to keep in mind that this is kind of what is happening in practice. So yeah. They go to the fire room, open the balcony door, yeah. And then try to ventilate.
Yeah. Yeah. And you actually see that on the left movie, a scene from gang 1.3, fire service arrives, opens up the fire compartment, turns on the ventilator, and I have to make the small note with that at that point, these firefighters thought that an outlet for the ventilation had been made, but it hadn't, or not large enough. And this is the result, that even two fire doors beyond, you can see actually that smoke is growing by the second.
Yeah, and Thijs will show you tomorrow some more examples, but even if you have an outlet and you will try to ventilate inside the building, it's quite difficult. So ventilation is an art. If you don't know what you're doing, it's really difficult because pressures are quite important. Yes.
Yeah. So actually we see two observations in this. First of all, that simply showing up and doing something is a risk. Because one way or the other, you're going to influence the ventilation profile of the building. And second of all, as Lieve said, ventilating is an art. And some more impression. Also, the firefighting crew going in.
Yeah, maybe for firefighters this is logic, but this is what you see if you enter this corridor.
Yeah.
I think planning hands is then...
It's difficult.
Quite difficult.
Yeah, you see that conditions change so rapidly that decision making, especially from the outside, is virtually impossible. If you would be standing outside, out of this building, you're just seeing a building. You're not seeing anything. You're not seeing this happening inside. So we have to look at our decision making process as to who makes the decisions and why we make those decisions. In terms of, we have to make it in such a way that the person who does it actually has a view of what's happening inside.
Yeah, so you can imagine that you can plan all kinds of things and say to people, you have to open this door, and then after a couple of minutes, this door. In this case, they were briefed. They should have known what they were doing. And what did we see? That sometimes they miss a door. Because it's very difficult to see where you are. So you can, if you translate this to practice, you can see what's going to happen.
Yeah, there's a very large difference between the optimum way of fighting fire and rescuing people and actual practice, simply because conditions are this difficult.
So let's wrap it up.
Yeah. Our main observation is that what we actually see is that a chain approach consisting of several linked measures would be the optimum way forward if we actually want to reduce smoke propagations. And there are actually two reasons for that. First of all, that a combination of measures will have the most optimum result from an objective point of view. And second of all, if we have several measures, linked measures, if one of those should fail, there is always one or two other measures that will still work. As an example, we have always relied on the door as being the separation method to contain the smoke. And we have seen now how vulnerable that door is and opening that door is in terms of the risk for the rest of the building. And I think that all the firefighters within this room can name two, perhaps even more, examples of the fact that people know they should not open the door in case of this, but they do, because that's simply the human factor. That's simply human behavior under these circumstances.
That's the meaning of a door.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
To be able to open it. Yeah. Yeah. So that would actually mean that we would suggest, based on the findings we have so far, first of all, to look at the source of the problem, the furnishment. If we should have fire, or should we say smoke-safe furnishment, we would reduce the problem. If we could then limit the problem by automatic suppression, you have a different layer of safety. And if you then have a third layer of safety in terms of smoke containment, you would have an optimum way to stop smoke propagation.
Maybe this is obvious, and you're now thinking, okay, why did they do this research? Sometimes research is obvious.
Yep.
Okay, so let's go on. What are we going to do? Because, as Hans told you, have a lot of data, and we still need to do a lot of things. For example, we measured obscurity, and we can translate this to visibility. Don't look at the absolute values, but you can see what's happening here. So if you look at the left chart, the gray and the blue line are visibility at 1.5 meters in the hallway. If you can remember the video, they correspond really well with the video, I think. And the other two lines are at 30 centimeters. So we have this for all the tests. So we need to look in what does this mean and translate this to escapability and maybe survivability. And on the other graph is a chart for pressure. And this is actually one of the pressure charts which we found with the more smoke-resistant separation. So kind of high pressures, I think. So before the door is opened, pressures between 200, 300 pascals. And then after the door is opened and closed again, we saw kind of a big spike moving up to 800, 1000 pascals. And you can imagine what's going to happen. In this short time frame, smoke is pressed to the most leakage ways or the most weak things in the separation. That's not all. We're also going to do look at the radiation and our other measurement equipment. And of course, we also had to look at the gases. And gases is also quite a job, gas analysis. So we thought, okay, we can do this, but we cannot do this on our own. So we asked the National Institute for Public Health and Environment to do the kind of measurements at the first five tests. They did it with infrared spectrometry, like that.
F-tier.
Okay. And we used electrochemical sensors for our own measurements. And we try to look at compare some of those. And you see here the green line is what RUVM measured, and the other lines is what we measured. And those are the figures in the corridor. You can see that they're quite the same. Almost look like if we made it the same. It isn't. You have to trust me on this.
So in terms of reliability, this is
also
this
quite
looks,
good.
This looks positive.
Yes. So this, yeah, this looks quite good, I think. So let's go to the next slide. Maybe you can start the video, Hans. Because as I told you, we also saw some other paths of propagation which we didn't understand yet. This is at the second floor. the room above the fire compartment. And look closely, because here in the corridor, in the middle, you can also see smoke coming out of the shafts. And we saw something else. We saw that smoke is not always the best clue where it goes or where it comes from. And this is actually the sockets in adjacent rooms where smoke is pressed through. So you can see that you have all kinds of paths you didn't think of before. This is maybe not, you cannot see this really, really well, but also here from this socket, there is smoke propagation.
Yeah. Let me tell again about how that the measurement of carbon monoxide didn't always correspond with the visibility of the smoke.
Yes, so you know, if as a firefighter, you use your eyesight quite often, because this is one thing you have in your toolbox when you're entering something. But what we're seeing, or what we think we have seen, is that if there is soot, that most of the time means that there are all kinds of harmful gases. But if there's no soot, that doesn't mean, or no smoke, that doesn't mean that there are also not harmful gases. So if you then use your eyesight as something, for example, to ventilate, if you don't know where the bad gases are, you will propagate them to all kinds of places you didn't think of. So that's a kind of a difficulty. Okay, something else. Because what we did before our test is also we did some simulations, because we wanted to know what's going to happen, what's going to happen to our measurement equipment. But we also do, or trying to do, of going to do simulations afterwards. And we're not going to do this on our own. So Jean-Michel, this is actually your model. Thank you. Mm-hmm. If you do want to know something about this, this is a FDS model we are preparing. So what is our idea? We want to fit the model at our data from the experiments and then try to look at all kinds of variations we couldn't do in our tests. And here you see some kind of video. It's not about the absolute figures, but it gives you an idea how this could work. And Jean-Michel will help us with this, I think. Yes, eh? Yeah. Thank you. Yes.
We hope so.
Oh, that's arranged. Nice.
And of course, after this sneak preview of the final findings, you want to know more.
Of course, you want to know more.
Yeah.
Or not.
We want to know more. Yes. So, yeah. There's the first possibility to do that is to go to two workshops tomorrow. Colleague Thijs Geertsema and Ruud van Liemt will present a workshop. Ruud will present a workshop about more the fire prevention view on things, such as smoke separation, mobile water mist, etc. And Thijs will do a workshop on fire service tactic and the effect that has on smoke propagation. So you're all invited to join them for the workshop. And finally, because our chair is getting a little bit impatient, and he already was getting impatient 5 minutes ago, so I really have to hurry.
Oh, I thought he said we had five more. Because he did this.
What we have shown you today is the result of team effort. We're very proud of the team, and we hope as a team to make a contribution to fire safety, not only in the Netherlands, but through you also to the rest of Europe. And with the team, we don't mean only the core team which is pictured on this photograph, but also the dozens of firefighters, the fire investigators from all over the country who assisted us in this research. And we want to thank all of those members for all the contributions so that Liewe can go on analyzing all the data.
Yay.
Thank you very much.
Hans and Liewe, thank you very much for this information, and still a lot of data to go for research for conclusions, but it gives us a nice insight of the research you did already. I still feel pity about there's a person somewhere working for IKEA in Sweden. after the first ordering failed, he received a second ordering on short notice to produce 25 sofas, and now seeing on YouTube that they all set on fire.
Yeah.
Okay.
I can assure
you. You have to deal with that.
I can assure you, they were there.
They were there. Okay.
And saw how their sofas were burnt.
Okay. So okay.
Yeah, but the sofas had a very short lifespan. That's correct.
that's true. Is there any question in the audience for these two guys before we go to pause? Everybody once a break, I think. No questions? Yes, one question, please.
Yes, throw the mic.
Throw the mic. And please speak in the black
sector. Adam Course from Avon Fire and Rescue Service in the UK. I was just wondering, this is a very interesting presentation. Would you have any plans to repeat this in high-rise buildings, as an example?
Well, actually, we were going to advise the English Fire and Rescue Service on high-rise experiments that were due in London, but they were cancelled. So perhaps you can make we can point some date. If you provide the high rise, if you provide the crews and equipment, etc.,
we come over.
Then we come over to advise.
Very good. Okay, that deal is set. Some more questions, please.
Is it this way? Okay.
Yeah.
First of all, I would like to thank you for their nice presentation. I really enjoyed it. Like with the FTS that you showed in the end, I would like to know that you validated the FTS model in the end, that you were able to reproduce all the observations with FTS, right?
Yeah,
we're still not there yet, but we're going to do. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And because we had this fixed scenario, what I didn't show you, we also measured the mass loss. So we have kind of an idea what the fire scenario is, so what the heat release rate is. We know what's burning. We did all kinds of measurements in the gases, so we know quite well what the scenario is. So that's how we try to validate it afterwards and try to make a circle. So we try to make a circle where this model will produce the same results, and if it does, then we're going to expand it in all kinds of variations.
Yeah, because for me it's quite interesting to see that the software that I use in my daily job, you know, what is the accuracy, what is the level of accuracy. We use it in our simulation, but it's quite interesting to see that how accurate is, you know, based on the reality.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks.
Thank you.
Last question, somebody, for the last question. Here, okay. Mm. Please, Ken.
Yes, throw it.
Really?
Yeah, really. Ooh.
Thank you. I saw a door opening after 5 minutes and a lot of smoke coming out. What were the tenability conditions in the apartment at that time? Was it still possible for that amount of smoke for people to get out?
Yeah, it's a good question. We don't know that, but could be that it's not tenable anymore. So, of course, so I already said that if the door opens, when it opens, and how long it's opened, that's quite different. So you could say, why did you choose 5 minutes? So, of course, we could have seen it after 3 minutes. That's also something we maybe want to know. If you, with simulations, if you move this time more to the front, do you have the same tenable situation in the fire room or in the corridor? But it's a good question.
And it's a good series of experiments.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.